Hello and Xin Chao, Harkus CGTV, back with another Asian interview with Haiphong and Vietnamese national player Martin Lo. Welcome to Harkus CGTV, where we have the Martin Lo on the show today.
Thank you for having me. I'm excited to have a chat with you.
I'm not so sure about that. Depending on the way this goes. Okay, so obviously with my Scottish accent and your Australian accent and my Vietnamese not being anywhere near as good as your Vietnamese, I am going to try and speak as slowly as possible so that everyone can understand. You were picked up to play for Football New South Wales at the National Training Centre.
The New South Wales Institute of Sport.
So what age did you go and play there?
That started from 15.
So were you playing a lot of football before that? The reason that I ask you about the youth development football is because a lot of the younger Vietnamese that we have that watch this that are trying to work out ways to get involved in Vietnamese football. So you were 15 when you went?
I think the thing is in Australia it's a lot different to Vietnam in terms of the youth development from young. Already from ages like 8 or 9, I was playing more than 30 games a year.
Okay.
But in Vietnam, the academies, the players maybe play like less than 10 games a year.
Yeah.
And just mostly training. Yeah.
Okay. So, and then you played for Western Sydney Wanderers, still in the youth team?
I signed my first contract in the youth team at 15. And then when I just turned 17, I signed my first pro contract with them.
Okay. Now, something I should show you. So one of my first clubs, and still my favorite Vietnamese club is Phu Hien. And you moved to...
Oh, wow.
See, I've got all the magic shirts here. But this is one of my pride of place tops, my Phu Hien top. And still, I would arguably say that I think Phu Hien have some of the most passionate fans. Certainly when I went up to Hanoi, up at the PVF, some really welcoming guys. With my very bad Vietnamese and their very bad English, it could still work out that they're just brilliant football supporters. The question I had for you though about Phu Hien was, when you got to the PVF, did you know that the facilities were as good as they were at the PVF? Was that a surprise to you?
Oh, that was a massive surprise. I remember I met with one of the coaches in Saigon before I went there, and he told me that I wouldn't believe it when I saw it.
Yeah.
And then the day came, I was driving, and I could already see the stadium from outside driving into the academy.
Yeah.
And when I got inside, I couldn't believe it, because in Australia we don't even have something like this.
Yeah. It's incredible. It's absolutely incredible. It blew my mind away when I saw the size of the swimming pools, the outdoor pitches, all that kind of stuff. Would just
everything. So the 360 room?
Yeah, with the ball coming out in the 360 room. Yeah. What was your score on that? Were you good? Did you get to use that a lot?
I used it when I was coming back from injury. Normally, no one gets to use that. Only players going through rehabilitation.
Okay.
But that actually had a lot of problems, so they couldn't use it a lot, unfortunately.
Okay. It's a nice bit of kit though, and I like the size of the swimming pool and the cool pools and the gym, the big massive gym. It's just,
I used to swim there every morning when I was living there. It was the best.
Yeah, it was incredible. And I just really wish that they had something like that in the south of Vietnam as well, because it really needs something like that. And in an ideal situation, a couple of them in the north, a few in the middle, round about Da Nang, round about Hue, and some down in the south, because that's what they really need. So you, so about 2020, you moved to Haiphong, a club that's had quite a few overseas-based Vietnamese players, Van Lam, Michael Nguyen, Schmidt, a good few others. So it's a good kind of base for you. So what's your goals there?
So I think when I heard about all those players who were also like me, Vietnamese-born overseas players, I was I had a feeling that maybe the club treated us better.
Yeah.
I mean, not saying better than other people, but they could understand our situation better, because in other clubs, we would actually get attacked a lot, because not a lot of people liked the Vietnamese players who came from overseas,
right?
Like me and Lam and stuff. And if you ask all of them, every club they've been to in Vietnam, they've had some sort of problems with players or coaching staff. And you know, it was really difficult, so I thought going there would be better, but unfortunately it wasn't the case with the first chairman.
So why do you think the reason for that is? What kind of problems have you encountered?
Mostly, like, for example, language barrier could be something that they could take the wrong way. I mean, I have no problem with any of my teammates, but when I first came, I couldn't speak Vietnamese at all. And a lot of us foreigner players in the professional environment overseas, when you finish your training, you go home, you take your personal time, you relax. But in Vietnam, it's more of a culture that the players stick together like brothers, and you guys will go have coffee, go have dinner, do everything together. But for us, like for me, who's someone who's lived in Australia and been in a professional environment, after training, I don't want to see anyone in my team. I just want to go home, relax, you know, talk with my other friends, my family. And then because you spend most of your days with these guys, you travel together with these guys, you know. So it's not like I have a personal problem. I need my own space.
Yeah, sure.
So I think a lot of the foreigner players, and I think even foreigner people, kind of have that thing. Like after work, they just kind of want to be with their friends or whatever.
Yeah, just switch off. Park Hansio had saw you and called you to the Vietnam U22 squad to prepare for the Southeast Asia Games U23 Championship, but sadly you never made it into the final squad. Why, from a personal level, do you think that was? And did it make you more determined to try and get into the squad the next time?
For me, I guess I wasn't expecting so much, because the players that were in my squad with me, these guys have been playing from so young together. And obviously me just coming to Vietnam as a Vietnamese born in Australia, someone whose Vietnamese was not even good yet, it was very hard for me to kind of gel together as a team and understand each other in the team. But overall, my ability at that time was not enough for what they want as a player in their squad. Yes, of course, after not being selected, I was more determined, but I became more realistic as to under 23s is obviously, like in Vietnam, a lot of people who don't know a lot about football think that this is supposed to be the best time of your career, the under 23s. But honestly, a lot of players who play in the under 23s, you will not see them play in the national team. Yeah. So I guess my goals change. Like under 23s is not really something that I need to be playing at. The most important is to be in the national team.
Yeah.
And that might be a year, that might take 5 years, but I don't want to rush myself. I want to do well and perform well for my club first. Yeah. And if I do well, then it speaks for himself. It speaks for itself, and I'll get my chance.
Yeah. So that kind of leads on nicely to the next question. Did you have a favorite Vietnamese player growing up, or do you have a favorite Vietnamese player just now that you look up to?
I never knew any of the Vietnamese players when I was in Australia, or even when I first came. I only knew about Lee Nguyen from the US.
Yeah.
He was a big reason onto why I decided to come back and try it out.
Okay.
In terms of a player in Vietnam that I look up to, I think from the beginning, in my first interviews, I always said that I was really impressed with Duan An from the national team.
Okay.
And I saw a lot of matches before when he was younger, and I was really impressed.
The other thing that we wanted to speak about as well, moving away from football, something that's kind of catching a lot of people's eye is the new venture that you have off of the football pitch. It's your clothesline, Keeping It 100.
Okay.
I want to kind of speak a little bit about this more. Like, what is your, where did you get the name from for a start? I saw one of the videos that you did, and you had a lot of research for the logo. So obviously with the KIOH logo, the way it's all brought together, you did all of that, right? You've done all the marketing, everything, or have you had people helping you?
I've basically done everything, from designs, from physically going to the factories to give them my design template so they can recreate what I have in my head. The logo, the first logo I ever had in 2017 was all done by me. And for the current logo, which I remade in 2020, I had some help from a family member to make it what it is now. But the idea was always, I drew the idea that I had for that logo that I have now, I drew it on paper. I just didn't know how to make it digital, so I just had help doing that. But other than that, everything is I've done by myself. The shipping, even in Haiphong, I ship personally with my motorbike. I just want to learn everything in how it works, how this business runs. And then when the time comes that I need to hire staff, I can understand what type of work they need to do and how I think is the best way to do it and the most effective way.
So is this you setting up for you running a business along with your football, or is this you trying to look at another venture for you to give you something to fall back on? Or where would you have it in your football career, the clothesline versus your football career?
Oh, I mean, obviously, it doesn't compare right now. My career is my priority. I mean, with the last recent COVID outbreak and the break that we had, it gave me a lot of time to build it more. And so I just wanted to challenge myself and see how much I could build it in the few months that I had, just to see the potential that it had and what it could eventually build up to for after my career, or even during it, if it really kicks off, then I can really put more time.
Yeah, we're going to put the links up on the screen and down in the description below as well, so that people can click on that. Is there any physical stores, or is it just buying online just now, or is there anywhere in Hanoi or Haiphong that, or even Ho Chi Minh City, that you can buy it?
At the moment, it's all online. I think I would love to have a physical store. I think in this time now with COVID, it's not a very smart financial decision.
Yeah.
For a clothing store, that is, as well. So I think in the future, when everything is better, I will definitely want to open something. And I had planned for Ho Chi Minh, so.
Okay. Yeah. Well, you know for sure, I know a lot of people that will be going down there, and hopefully this brings you more customers as well. So we're going to move into the quick fire round.
Yeah, that.
The simple rules of this is you have 2 seconds to think about it, and you're not allowed to pass. So you just have to give the answer that comes into your head. And I might even be...
What if I don't?
What about what?
What if I'm just speechless? I got nothing for you.
then I will superimpose an answer in after whichever one that I want your answer to be. Make it more difficult.
Okay.
So quick fire round: Australian barbecue in snags or Vietnamese barbecue with hot pot?
Aussie snags and
barbecue. Okay. Jose Mourinho or Pep Guardiola?
Pep.
Prada or Armani?
Prada.
Okay, Notorious B.I.G. Notorious B.I.G. or Tupac?
Oh, not this question.
Yeah,
this. This one's a very impossible question to answer.
That's why Tupac. It's a difficult question. Tupac. Okay. Hanoi. Hanoi or Ho Chi Minh City?
Ho Chi Minh.
Ho Chi Minh, good answer. Beach holiday or a ski break?
Beach.
Beach, okay. So this, the last question, this is from an Australian friend of mine who said, what would you prefer, gills to be able to breathe like a fish or wings to be able to fly like a bird?
Wings.
Wings? Why wings? What's the reason?
Yeah, wings.
Why?
Because I probably won't die from drowning. I probably will die from falling off something.
That is the end of the quick fire round, and we're coming to the end of the interview. Biggest question: what is next for Martin Lowe?
So, just to keep it simple, I just want to continue to challenge myself in my football career. You know, I think a lot of that will come down to the decision where I decide to play. So that will be interesting in the next few weeks or months on my decision. Also, I would I'm really looking into more into business now. I've had the last 3 months to learn more about it and find new ways to pursue different avenues in business. So I'll definitely be trying to get into that more in the next year or so, and hopefully I can create something great. So yeah, that's also apart from what I'm doing with Kaya right now too. I'm just trying to get my nose into as many things and try and learn as much as I can.
We wish you all the very best of luck with the clothesline and of course football career. I'm sure that I will be somewhere watching you play for the national team pretty soon. Of that I am completely sure. So best of luck in the career, best of luck with the clothesline, and thanks very much for coming on the show.